Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-Aliyy al-Azim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa abil qasim al-Mustafa Muhammad. Wa ala alihi tayyibin al-tahirin. La siyama baqiyatillahi fil aradhin. Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. Wa ja'alana min a'wanihi wa ansarih inshaAllah. Today we want to talk about prophethood as the third principle of faith. Normally, Muslim theologians, when they talk about prophethood or nubuwwah, they discuss in two sections. One is what they call an-nubuwwatul amma, general prophethood. And that is about the institution of prophethood, the fact that we need revelation, we need guidance from God the Almighty through prophets. And then they talk about an-nubuwwatul khassa, and that is a specific prophethood, which is the mission of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The first is shared by all believers in the Abrahamic faith, Muslims, Christians, Jews. They all share the same idea that throughout the history, there have been people who have been appointed by God, and God communicated to them, revealed to them his message, and the rest of human beings had to follow them and listen to their teachings. Of course, in Christianity, there is a difference here that they believe that by the arrival of Jesus, the revelation changed. The revelation was transformed. Up to Jesus, it was very much the same as what we believe or Jews believe. In other words, the prophetic figures in the Old Testament are accepted by the Christians in the same way that we accept. Of course, they don't believe in the infallibility of the prophets, but they believe that there were people who were acting as prophets. But then they believe that in the New Testament, in the new era for humanity, then God decided to send his own son instead of sending revelation to someone. Salaam alaikum. So God revealed himself through his son. Previously, God was revealing himself through his words to the prophets. Now God has revealed himself in his son. So this is why they call Jesus himself to be the revelation from God. So this is there is a difference here between us and Christians about prophet Isa. So they don't believe Isa was a prophet. But as I said, they believe that there were prophets before Isa. There were people to whom God communicated. They believe in Moses, in Noah, in Abraham, in Lot, in Zechariah, in many prophets. So this is some idea which is shared by all believers in Abrahamic faith. And this is why what we call the people of the book, Ahl Kitab, because they all believe that there was a divine book for guidance of human beings. Of course, today Christians deny that there was anything as a book given to Jesus or any revelation to Jesus, because he himself was revelation. But we believe that they are the people of the book because they accept the idea of the revelation. So we have two discussions. One is general prophethood, and the second is a specific prophethood. Today I will try to complete the discussion about general prophethood, and inshallah, in the next session, we will talk more about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. First of all, why do we need to have prophets? Why we cannot say that human reason is enough, is sufficient? Especially nowadays that we have lots of experiences, we have been able to develop different sciences, different disciplines to help us. So why we cannot say that now we no longer need any religion, any guidance from God? The answer to this is very clear. Although God has provided us with reason, with intellect, with aql, and we have great respect for aql, especially in the school of Ahlul Bayt, to the extent that we take aql to be one of two hujjah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of two proofs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we have in our hadith, inna lillahi ta'ala 'ala an-nas hujjatayn. Hujjatan zahira wa hujjatan batina. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has two ways of communicating his will to us. One is the external one, and that is through prophets, and one is the internal one, that is through reason. Or as we have a beautiful analogy, that prophets are internal. Prophets are externalized aql. If it was possible to embody aql in the form of a human being, that would be a prophet. An aql is an internalized prophet. If there is any part of our being that can guide us, that can teach us like prophet, that's our aql. Not our qalb, our heart, not our emotion, not our perception. That's only our aql, our reason, which is a hujja, which is a proof. So we have great respect for aql. And by no means we want to undermine the role of aql or reason. But still we believe that we are in need of extra guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? There are different arguments. Muslim theologians, Muslim philosophers have developed different arguments. But I think it's not very difficult to understand, especially for us. Now, after seeing all different schools of thought, especially in the 19th and 20th century, we have seen many, many isms. And for a while, they have been able to attract sometimes millions of people. Sometimes many governments, many countries were founded on their basic tenets. Like, for example, communism. Communism was a very powerful ideology. And many people in many countries were attracted by communism. Actually, they managed to rule half of the world. But today, no one is interested in communism. And many, many things, especially if you study history of philosophy, you find that there have been many, many different philosophies that come, and then they attract people. They have some people who adhere to them. After a while, people find that there are some problems. Then they go for something else. Human understanding is very much limited, very much subject to change, to modification. Even if we look at our sciences, especially humanities, which is something to be like a kind of candidate for substituting or replacing religion. If you cannot say engineering, or, for example, medicine can replace religion. If anything can replace religion, would be like, for example, psychology, education, these kind of humanities, human sciences. But if you look at these disciplines, for example, psychology, can psychology really guide us and help us from divisions, from doubts, from disagreements? No. If you read any textbook on psychology, you would find that even in the definition of psychology, they disagree. In their methodology, they disagree. What is the subject matter of psychology? They disagree. What is the definition of human being? They disagree. Up to 60s, there was a great interest in behavioralism, and they reduced everything to human behavior. They didn't believe in any spirit or soul. Human being is just the behavior, and that is the subject matter of psychology. When they face problems, then they realize, no, there is something more. It's not just behavior. This behavior must come out of something. There must be some root, something out of which this behavior appears. Then they become more inclined to accept spirit or soul. So even these disciplines like psychology, like education, they are not really giving us a unified message. They cannot save us from going to different directions. As I said, even in their definition, in the subject matter, in methodology, in their understanding of human being, which are the very basic things, they disagree. Look at the experience of modern societies, that they try to take into account all the experiences of the past, all the possible, you know, scientific methods, all the research that they undertake. Still, you see, so much change is happening. They make some legislation, then after a while, they realize that that was a mistake. Then they make another legislation. Sometimes they oppose something, then later they make it compulsory. Or something which was compulsory, then they become against it. Sometimes big nations, they cannot agree on simple things. Even, you know, in the, for example, European, for example, you know, council, it's not that they can agree. On many things, they disagree. Of course, when it comes to certain issues which relate to us, they agree. But when it's related to themselves, normally they disagree. So human being is really in need of guidance, especially if we take into account the fact that we have only one life. We cannot say, okay, let us try different schools of thought, and then for the second life, when we are more experienced, then we know what to do. When we die and then we are revived and given a second chance, then we know what to do. No, unfortunately, we don't have such a chance. We have only a very short, very limited life. And we cannot take any risk, especially if you look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our creator, who has created us for a purpose. He cannot take any risk of leaving us to ourselves and say, okay, let them do whatever they want. And even if they cannot find a way, even if they are not, for example, guided, salam alaikum. That doesn't matter. That doesn't bother me. No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very much concerned about every single human being. There is a story that once one of the prophets, who was very much tired with his people, and you know, he felt that his people are not accepting. So he was bored. So he cursed them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is a story, maybe it's not a true story, but it's good for getting some inspiration. And maybe it's true because we had prophets who cursed their people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, before I listen to you, you must take a slot of land and make it ready for planting some trees. So it needs lots of work to make a land which is not used, you know, for farming or agriculture, to make it ready. And then plant seeds for trees. He did all that. Then gradually they grew and they grew, and then the trees were very beautiful, very strong, and they were just to bear fruits. Then God told him, now you must set on fire to all of them and burn all these trees and damage the garden. He said, I cannot do this. I have done all these, you know, efforts. Now it's ready to bear fruits. It's very, very painful for me. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, so how do you want me to destroy my people? You curse them and you want me to kill them? Every single human being is very valuable to me. So why do you want me to kill and destroy them? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has great concern for every human being. So he cannot just sit indifferent and see what is happening to people. People killing each other, people getting confused, and say, okay, it's not my business. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides not only human beings, every living being, if not every being, with some kind of guidance. And this is general guidance. If you look at animals, if you look at birds, if you look at insects, if you look at something which is very simple in our eyes but very complicated and sophisticated, like ants, like bees, so you find that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided them. When Pharaoh asked Prophet Musa and Harun, you know, when these two great prophets went to Pharaoh, so Pharaoh asked them, who is your Lord, Ya Musa? Man rabbukuma, Ya Musa? Who is your Lord? They said, Rabbuna alladhi a'ata kulla shay'in khalqahu thumma hada. Our Lord is the one that has given everything its creation and then has guided it. Everything, this is why I said it's not even living beings. Even non-living beings, they are guided. If we know more about what is happening inside, for example, an atom, then we will see that everything is very carefully planned, to the extent that if hundreds of scientists work for many, many years, still they think that they need to know more to find what is the plan, what is the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has designed these things. So there is a general guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to everything. And this is what we have also in Surah A'la. الَّذِي خَلَقَ فَسَوَّى وَالَّذِي قَدَّرَ فَحَدَى. Allah is the one who has created and then completed what he has created and has given measure to everything. Everything in this world has a measure. Nothing goes out of the limits. And he has guided everything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very concerned. And I think if we were in his place and we were wise, we would be the same. We would not leave our creatures just in chaos. But when it comes to human beings, Allah has a special guidance, extra guidance for them. It's not only guidance through instincts. It's also extra guidance, and that is through revelation. So this guidance is not to replace our aql, but it's to support, it's to strengthen our aql. It's to supplement our aql. Imam Ali alayhi salam has a very beautiful saying here, which you find it in many, many books. And they talk about philosophy of prophethood. They all mention to this beautiful articulation of Imam Ali. Imam Ali refers to the philosophy of sending prophets. And he says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent prophets for different reasons. One, لِيُثِيرُ لَهُمْ دَفَاءِنَ الْعُقُولِ, so that the prophets on dig and on earth all the treasures which are buried. Which treasures? دَفَاءِنَ الْعُقُولِ, all the things which we were able to know by our aql, but now, because we didn't know how to listen to our aql and how to function our aql properly, they are all buried, they are all hidden. The prophets have come to unearth all those jewelries and remind us of those things that we were able to know, but we didn't know. We have in Surah Qaf that on the day of judgment, people would say, لو كنا نسمع أو نعقل ما كنا في أصحاب السعير. If we were just listening and thinking and using our aql, we were not now in hell. Just listening and using our aql is enough. Use your aql and listen to the prophets. So one job of the prophets is to ask us, listen to your aql and to revive your aql. So this is one. Second, يُذَكَّرُوهُمْ مَنْسِيَّ نِعْمَتِهِ. One job of the prophets is to remind us of the forgotten blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Allah has given us and we have forgotten, so we cannot benefit from. Allah has given us many, many blessings and we have forgotten. So the prophets remind us. They mention to us the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other thing is, لِيَسْتَعَدُوهُمْ مِيثَاقَ فِتْرَتِهِ. The prophets ask us to fulfill the requirements of the covenant which we have made with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is an innate, there is an inbuilt covenant between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the prophets ask us to keep our promise and to be loyal to the covenant that we have made with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know the story of the universe of particles of Al-Mizar. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided humanity with prophets. In the Quran, some prophets are mentioned by their names. More than 20 prophets, if I don't make mistake. I think it's 25, but maybe I'm wrong. I didn't check today. But more than 20 prophets are mentioned by their names. But the Quran itself says that there are many that we have not mentioned their names. And according to Hadith, 124,000 prophets were sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran very clearly says that Allah has sent prophets to all nations. لَقَدْ بَعَثْنَا فِي كُلَّ أُمَّةٍ رَسُولًا. We have sent prophet, messenger to every group of people. So you shouldn't be surprised if, for example, we later discover that maybe there have been some prophets sent to China. Some prophets maybe have been sent to Africa. Some prophets, you know. Most of the prophets that we know are from the Middle East, because they are all from the descendants of Ibrahim, from Middle East. But Allah says that He has sent prophets to all groups of people. Of course, there are some scientific theories about where human beings actually started and when they traveled. Maybe they all started, you know, in Africa, and then they traveled to different continents. But What is important is Allah has never left any nation without guidance. So this is what Quran is very clear about this. And Allah also says that he has sent all these prophets with a language that people could understand. لَسَانَ قَوْمِهِ, with the language of his own people. So this is the idea of general prophethood. If I want to just very briefly mention the jobs of the prophets, I can say one was to remind human beings of the things that they themselves knew or at least could know. This is a very detailed discussion about what are the things that we can know by our reason, especially when it comes to morality. Are human beings able to understand basic moral values by their reason or not? We believe yes. We believe that human beings can understand basic moral values by their reason, and the prophets come to remind and to emphasize. So you don't need to be a Muslim or a Christian to find out that honesty is good. Just to be a human being is enough to understand honesty is good. Or for example, to betray or to, for example, oppress people is bad. So prophets come not to teach us basic values, but to remind us of the basic values that we were able to understand ourselves. Second, the prophets come and teach us many things that we couldn't understand. So when it comes to the things that we could understand, they remind us and emphasize. But they also teach us many things that we couldn't understand. For example, we could understand that we should worship our Creator. But what is the best form of worship? What is the most fruitful type of worship that can make our relation to our Creator very close? What are those types of worship that can be very fruitful for our eternal life? We couldn't understand by our reason, by our aql, because we don't have experience. If someone asks you what kind of, for example, dress and food I should take when I want to travel to some part of the world, and you have no experience, no knowledge about that, how can you guide him? If you live there, if you have been there, you can tell him something. But if you have no experience, you cannot tell him. So no human being has ever traveled to the Akhirah and brought us news or, you know, make any report to us. If it was not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the teaching of the prophets, we wouldn't know. Yes, we would know that there must be some judgment, but we wouldn't know what type of judgment would be there and what are the things which are helpful, what are the things which are very harmful. This is very important so that we can know what to do. Sa'di has a beautiful story. He says, once a person who was a tradesman, he was, you know, doing trade. He was taking, you know, some goods from this, for example, part of the world, taking to the other part of the world, selling them, and then buying other goods and bringing back and selling in his own town and making money. So once he traveled, and he found that the bell which they used to have in the public bath, you know, when they had public bath, they had a kind of bell to announce, to make, you know, announcements. So he found that that bell, which in his own town was very expensive, maybe for example 100 dirham, in that place is 1 dirham. So said, this is very good business. If I spend all my money on buying bells, and take them with me to my home and sell them, then I will make lots of money. Maybe I don't need to go for any trip in future. So he spent all his money on buying bells. And then he took bells to his own town. But what he found was that there was no demand, because in their town there was only 2 or 3 public baths. They were not in need of hundreds or thousands of bells. So he lost. Why? Because he didn't know what is demanded. He didn't have experience. He thought it's very simple. You make some simple calculation. Okay, I buy 1 dirham and sell 100 dirham. I make 99 dirham. But this is not as easy as we think. It's very complicated, very sophisticated. Even great people cry when they remember the way that Allah is going to judge about what we have done. When Imam Sajjad alayhi salam, cries in Dua Abu Hamza, then we should know that it's very complicated, very sophisticated. So how can we say we understand everything by our aql? We don't have any experience. We are very naive. So there are many things that we learn through religion in respect to law, in respect to morality, in respect to beliefs. In these 3 major areas, we learn from religion. And also, the other thing which happens is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides us with some sanctions. Because sometimes, if we know something but there is no sanction, then we just disregard. Why we have so much stress on reward and punishment? It's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to encourage us, to strengthen our determination. Like, you know, for example, if you tell your, for example, little child that you should study, he or she may not study. But you say, okay, I buy, you know, some toy for you. I buy, you know, some, for example, bicycle for you. Or if you don't, for example, study, I will not give you, for example, you know, sweets, or I will not take you, for example, to holidays. This reward and punishment is to provide some sanction. So this is also important part of the religion, that religion gives us encouragement. Many of the religious people, many of us, that alhamdulillah are immune and safe from doing some bad things, if it was not the fear of punishment, maybe we would have done. We shouldn't think that we are very good people. It's really because many of us, only because we are, you know, fearful of the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or we are hopeful that Allah will reward us, so we manage to keep away from certain things. And still, unfortunately, sometimes we commit bad things. So this is the other aspect. The other thing that we need, and the prophets do, is that not only they give us theoretical lessons, but in their own lives, they give us examples. They exemplify what they say. And this is very important. If we knew everything, but we didn't have the chance to know about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or if we knew everything about justice, but we didn't know anything about Imam Ali and the way Imam Ali observed justice, it would be totally different scenario. Because just to know is not enough. To see actually someone who lives his faith and shows you how you can be committed to your faith in all difficulties of life, in all ups and downs, is something different. So the prophets also act as role models and examples. And here we have a very important doctrine. And we believe that all the prophets were infallible, especially in the school of Ahlul Bayt, because our Sunni brothers believe in the infallibility of the prophets, but many of them restrict the infallibility or isma of the prophets to their tabligh, to their mission. What does it mean? It means that in their personal life, they may not be infallible. It means that Musa or Isa or Ibrahim or Dawood may have done something wrong in their personal life. But when it comes to presenting the message of Allah, they were infallible. Or before they were chosen as a prophet, still they were not infallible necessarily. But in the school of Ahlul Bayt, our idea is that the prophets were always immune from sins and mistakes, whether in their personal life or in their prophetic life. And inshallah, next week, I will give you arguments for this. Not only arguments from hadith. No, I will give you rational arguments to find out why it is necessary to believe in the infallibility of the prophets. And then, inshallah, we will continue with a specific prophethood, and that is about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I think our time is over. We can have questions, and I will be very happy to listen to your questions.
Thank you very much, Sheikh. Can we take the first question from the ladies, please?
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
In Al Madar, did the prophets know they were going to become prophets?
In the universe or Alam Azhar, basically what was done was that all human beings were asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bear witness over themselves. And they were asked very basic question: am I not your Lord? إذ أخذ ربك من بني آدم من ظهورهم ذريتهم وأشهدهم على أنفسهم قال ألست بربكم قالوا بلى. So Allah asked us to bear witness over ourselves and then asked us, am I not your Lord? It means that if we really understand ourselves, we realize that Allah is our Lord. And this is why we have this hadith, من عرف نفسه فقد عرف ربه. And we all declared that you are our Lord. قالوا بلى. Whether in that alam we knew other things, this ayah doesn't speak about other things. But it's very much possible to believe that we were in a universe in which we were tried not only for this faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as our Lord, but actually for everything else we were tried. And then based on what we did in that trial, we were put in different circumstances in this world. But this needs a 1 hour discussion, and it's very important. When very helpful for understanding many things about, for example, Tina. You know, there are many hadiths about the clay from which we are created, and mu'minin being, for example, created from certain clay, and the people who are not mu'min from other clay, and many other things. Or, for example, why some people, for example, even before they become mature, like, for example, prophets and imams, even when they were in the, for example, womb of their mother, they were different. Why they were different? So this will all be helped and will be understood if we go into that discussion. But I cannot go into that discussion. But just to give you an answer, we can believe that before we come into this material world, we were all tested and tried in another world. But that world is not temporally before this world. When I say before, maybe before in rank, not before in time. And it's like a compressed or micro model of this life. So if, for example, you live in this world, inshallah, for 100 years, if you compress this 100 years into a moment, then every person in that moment is very much known that what kind of person that person is. So it's like a kind of short version or very compressed version of this life, which is parallel to this life. And maybe this is also one reason that it was called alam zar, because zar means small particles. Zarre means very, very small, little thing. Any question?
Question from the men?
Assalamu alaikum.
Salaam.
Sheikh, if we were tested prior to this world, then presumably everyone passed because they said yes, they accept Allah. And then why do we have so many evil people here today? I mean, how does that compare with what we have now?
Yeah. That test is different from what I said. That test, everyone said, yes, I declare that you are my Lord. This means that everyone has innate knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But it's not that everyone was loyal, was committed to this. So we believe that even in, for example, our situation today, in this 21st century, we still believe to come to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not very difficult. Because everyone has this inbuilt knowledge of Allah. Just you need to expose, you need to discover that. But to be committed, it was not something that everyone accepted. So what we have in that verse is not that everyone said, I am submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, everyone just said that you are my Lord. So this admission is there. But whether I am going to follow you, whether I am going to obey you, people are divided. Some people were very much successful. Some people failed. Just if you want to reflect more on this, maybe inshallah we can talk about it later if there is a time. But in the ziyarah of Lady Fatima, we have this in the beginning, that Ya Mumtahana, امتحنكِ الله الذي خلقكِ قبل أن يخلقكِ فوجدكِ صابرة. Oh, the one who is tried. Allah tried you before created you and found you patient. So what does it mean? Allah tried Lady Fatima before created her and found her patient. So this refers to the same fact.
Is there a question from the ladies?
No questions at present.
Anybody in the gent?
No question?
Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum.
Regarding the prophets, and that there's always a guide. Now, if there were there multiple prophets at the same time, also at the time of the last prophet, were there prophets at the same time? I know at the time of Prophet Ibrahim, there's Lut at the same time. But is it fair to assume that all over the world at the same time as Ibrahim and Isa, there were prophets all over? And is there any mention of that in the Hadith? Because I think I've heard that there was one from India called Kamran or something like this.
Yeah, so your question is that was it possible that there were more than one prophet at the same time?
Also, are there any mention of these prophets and do we have any stories about them?
Yes, according to Hadith, we know that sometime at the same time there were many prophets. Even sometime in the same town there were several prophets. The Quran doesn't mention this as a general pattern, but for example, we can understand from Quran, because for example, Quran talks about Musa and Harun, and they were both prophets and at the same time. Or for example, you know, Zakaria and Isa and Yahya, they were all prophets at the same time. Sometimes people killed 70 prophets in the same day. The Quran doesn't mention this, but we have in Hadith, but the Quran condemns some people for قَتْلِهُمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرَ حَقٍ. They killed prophets without any reason, without any legitimate reason. Mentions that they killed prophets, but in Hadith we find the details, more detailed than Hadith, that sometime in a day they killed tens of prophets. So this is very much the case, that sometime in a time there were more than one prophet. Especially in the past, in the remote places when they had no access and no communication, also it's very possible that, for example, a prophet maybe was in east of the world and another was in the west of the world, and they were doing their job. Maybe people even didn't know that there is such a prophet. You know, in the past, not only east and west, sometimes people didn't have any information about 100 kilometers away from them. Once one of my teachers in Tehran University was telling me that his mother or grandmother traveled from Tehran to Karaj, which is just 40 kilometers. And she said, I didn't know the world is so big. Just 40 kilometers, she found the world very big. So, because of lack of communication, it was necessary sometimes to have different prophets in different parts of the world. But, as I said, also sometimes in the same town. Because to be able to be a prophet needs some kind of capacity. And if several people at the same time had that capacity, then Allah would have chosen them as prophets. But only one of them, at most, could have the main message. And the rest were preaching that message. So this is why we distinguish between Nabi and Rasul. 124,000 Nabi. But Rasul is much more limited. Those were the people who had mission. So many of the prophets were basically like acting like ulama, like preachers. They were asking people to follow the message of a main prophet. And this is why we believe that some of the ulama of Islam may be higher in position than some of those prophets. As the Prophet Muhammad said, ulama ummati afzal min anbiya'i bani Israel. If these people were living in that time, they would have become prophets. Not all of them, some of them. So this is the situation about being a prophet. So sometimes you may have many prophets at the same time, but only at each time one main message was there for the people who were able to have access.
Is there a final question from the ladies?
No questions.
Men?
Then what is... Can then we say that if people are honest and they behave well and they good, they do good, are they entitled to go to heaven, or do they have to believe in the Prophet Muhammad and the Imam? How do you tie these things together?
Yeah, I said it's not just they remind what we could know. They also teach us new things. But if someone uses his aql properly, he comes to the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He comes to the knowledge that there must be a judgment. I must act, you know, virtuously. But many of the things still will not be known unless we have revelation. Because as I said, we don't have experience. We don't have knowledge. You know, our aql is very important, but we cannot understand everything by our aql. If I ask you, for example, you tell me what is happening now in the rugby car park. You cannot tell me by aql. Even if all of us put our aql together, we cannot understand what is happening now there. Because it's a matter of going and seeing what is happening. So many of the things we cannot know by our aql because our aql has no access. It's beyond the capacity of our aql. But we don't have anything in Islam against aql. So there is a difference between being against aql, anti-aql, or being beyond the scope of aql. We have many things beyond the scope of aql, which we learn from revelation, from wahy. So we need wahy and aql, revelation and reason, we need together. There is no conflict at all. These are two blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I always give this example, especially to my non-Muslim friends, when I want to explain what is Islamic understanding of aql, of reason, and revelation. I say there is no conflict because we believe these two are given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How is it possible that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us two conflicting messages? And then example is this. I say, if you invite someone to your house, you say, please come tomorrow for dinner to our house. Then he says, okay, what is the direction? You send him a direction by email. You also send your son, for example, and say, email is not enough. I want, you know, to send a person to make sure that they find the direction. And then your son gives another address other than what you send in email. If you do this, your guest would say, oh, this man didn't want me to go to his house. He has just confused me. He has given me one address by email and another address by his son. If you really wanted him to be there, you wouldn't have given two different addresses. So how is it possible Allah gives us one address by reason and another address by prophets, which oppose each other? It's impossible. This is why we believe, كُلَّمَا حَكَمَ بِهِ الْعَقْلِ حَكَمَ بِهِ الشَّرْعِ. Whatever judgment is made by aql is made by religion. And vice versa. So we have very peaceful mind, alhamdulillah. No conflict. We don't have anything which we would feel, you know, ashamed and say that this is something that it's against aql what we must accept. We don't have anything against aql.
Thank you very much, Sheikh. I know I said final question, but there were two questions at the same time. Does our brother still want to ask his question now?
Assalamu alaikum.
Say that the prophets are infallible. Does this mean that their task is easier than us because that would mean that they would be unable to commit bad, whereas we are able to commit sins? So they'd have... be guaranteed Jannah where we would not be guaranteed Jannah?
Yeah, very good question. Inshallah, next week we will talk about this. But briefly, the prophets were able to commit sin because they were human beings. But they didn't commit sin. So there is a difference between not committing sin and not being able to commit sin. It was not that case that they had no possibility of committing sin. No, they had all the possibility, all the means for committing sins. Indeed, sometimes they were much more severely tested than us. Like, for example, the test that Yusuf went through. That was a very difficult test. It's not that they don't have, for example, desire for sex, or they don't have desire for example, collecting money. They don't have desire, for example, for material gain. They have all these, but they manage to keep away. So esma or infallibility doesn't mean that they cannot commit sin. It means that they have not committed sin. And this is, to a great extent, not completely, possible for many of us. You know, we have the concept of edala. We say, for example, our marja must be adil, or even imam of the prayer must be adil. What does it mean? It means someone that doesn't commit sin. So even a normal person can manage to remain far from sin. But the difference between a marja and a prophet is that marja may commit sin. So up to the last moment, he must be always worried. He must always be... The prophets were able to make sins, but they didn't make sins. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of the test that they went through before, gave them some kind of extra support, a kind of extra care. But inshallah, if next week, inshallah, if you come, then I will talk more about this. So we must know that human prophets, even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was a person like us. قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. I am a human being like you. Yuha alay. The only difference is that he received revelation. Of course, this is a big difference. But he is not angel. He is not from another planet. He is a human being. And this is very important. He is a human being and he understands all the challenges that we go through. He is not someone with different mentality, with different, for example, need. He exactly understands what we are involved. And this is why he can become our role model. Otherwise, he cannot become our role model. If he had, you know, different type of nature, he would not have become our role model. It's a very good question. Thank you for the question.
Thank you very much, Sheikh. If we could all proceed now downstairs for Tabarak and Namaz. Salat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.